up a little bit, and it's probably a good thing because knowing the way Kansas weather is, since it's only flurries, we'll probably be driving in a blizzard down the Antrim. And we are going to take orders for t-shirts that say, "I survived the Christmas blizzard of 2015. We will do the birthdays, the announcements, and all that kind of at the end to give Nate a little more time to, since we've kind of changed things up so that we can let us start a little bit later. And Nate will go over the joys and concerns during the prayer. So if you would all let everybody sit down here while we're doing that. One thing coming up this in the next 2 weeks is, if you love high school basketball, it's high school basketball heaven. You know, we start Tuesday night, and I think the girls are up at the college, what, the week after? And all those things. So if you like college or high school basketball, this is your week for 2 weeks. If you would all now please turn into your call to worship, or to your bulletin, we'll turn to the call to worship, stand as you're comfortable, and we will read responsibly. Give everybody a second. God's steadfast love extends to the heavens. God's faithfulness reaches to the clouds. God's righteousness is as strong as the mountains.
God's judgments are as deep as the sea. God saves humans and animals alike. The shadow of God's wings protects the land.
Drink from the river of God's delight. Bathe in the fountain of life.
God's light is easy life. God's steadfast love saves the upright in cause.
If you would all now please remain standing and turn to hymn number 79, Holy God, We Praise Thy Name.
Thank you.
God, your name is revered from mountaintop to the sea. Your glory is praised in the east and in the west, in the north and in the south. Your spirit unites us through your wondrous gifts. Delight in us once more, Holy One, that the joy of your salvation may spill over into our lives and make us one with you and with one another. Guide our hearts and minds into the fullness of your grace, that we may truly be your people. Amen. May be seated. And now we have a special treat. We have loads of little kids, and they have been practicing, and they're going to sing for us.
Church, and we're trying to understand that they took him to a synagogue, which is like our church, but they came to worship God. Okay. Sing it. They want to hear you sing.
Heavenly Father, again this morning, we thank you for this this gift of the Spirit and the things that the Spirit gives to us, bestows unto us, graces us with, the gifts that we receive through the Spirit. We thank you for these things, the way that you have given them to us to serve your church. And we ask, Lord, that you would bless our efforts, that the people in our congregation and our community would be encouraged and built up and blessed through our use of those gifts in the church and in our community. This morning we praise your name, Lord, and thank you for joining us here this morning. And we thank you for your light that shines. We thank you for the joy that we have. As the children sang about just a few moments ago, thank you for the joy that we have in you. We ask, Lord, now that you would bless the rest of our time of worship. We
We also pray special prayer for healing for Jo as she recovers from that shoulder surgery. And thank you, Lord, for the release of the hostages and the soldiers. We know that all good things come from you, and so we give you due credit for what you have done to make that happen, to open doors for that. Lord, too, I thank you for each one here, and I pray, Lord, that you would bless them, that we would, as we have come to bless your name, to praise you, to worship you, to bring our tithes and offerings, to hear from your word, Lord, that you would bless us in return, that you would visit us even right where we're at, that no matter what life condition or situation we find ourselves in, you are mighty to save. You are able to meet us in that moment, in that situation, bring healing, bring purpose, bring hope, and bring peace. And so with these things in mind, we just lay our lives before you. We ask, Father, that you would receive us in your hands, take care of us, guide us. For those that are not here with us, Lord, whether because they are sick or because they stay home because of the weather or they're on vacation or visiting family somewhere, we ask, Lord, you return them home to us safely. We pray, too, that you would heal those who are ill and raise them up that they might return to worship you and bring glory to your name. In all these things, we give you thanks, and I invite you all to join with me praying as the Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and glory forever. Amen.
If you would all please turn in your hymnal to hymn number 400, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, and we will sing the first and the last verse. Jesus is Lord, except by the Holy Spirit. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to that same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another, the working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, the discernment of spirits. To another, various kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually, just as the Spirit chooses. May God add his blessing to the reading of his holy word.
The children sang, "If you're happy and you know it." And I thought it was interesting because I was thinking about the beginning verse of this passage. It said, "Now about spiritual gifts, brothers, I don't want you to be ignorant or unknowing." And so I was trying to think about a joke about ignorance is bliss, you know that statement, ignorance is bliss. But I couldn't find one, and so you should be all happy about that because I'm not very funny anyways. I took the trouble to put together a short outline to help you kind of get the main points today. This is a little bit of a departure from the type of preaching I normally do. It's because of the passage, it's much more of a teaching type message today, and so I wanted to give you a handout that would help you kind of remember some of the key things and somewhere to take notes as well. So make use of those as you feel necessary. So the first point today that Paul is concerned with about this, about spiritual the Holy Spirit and the ministry of the Spirit within us as a people of God, is to be knowledgeable about spiritual things. It's important that we gain as much knowledge as we can. Formerly, our pagan idols kept us ignorant because there is no intelligence in an idol. Something made out of wood or something made out of stone or something of our own making is not intelligent, and that's what Paul is saying to the people in Corinth, the church there, to make sure that they do not pay attention to the things that their idols taught them, which would be very little, if anything. So, and the Spirit of God works in the opposite way. He does not desire us to be ignorant, but rather educated. How many of our false idols would keep us ignorant? What do we consider to be our idols, the things that we worship? For some of us, we tend to worship various different things. Men, we like the outdoors. We like the sporting events. We like various different things, our hobbies and so forth. And sometimes we let that take priority over things that are most important. For some of us women, we tend to do things that take away from our family. Sometimes we work a little too much. Sometimes we talk a little bit too much. Sometimes we do a number of different things What idols do we have that would keep us ignorant of the things of God? It's a false or pagan god that would keep me from spiritual knowledge and awareness. How many times do I make an excuse every week why I don't take the time to open up my Bible, read it, to spend some time in prayer, praying for my neighbors who are needing prayer, praying for my family, praying for my children and husband and wife and so forth. How many times do I avoid that? How many times a week do I avoid obtaining or working to obtain more knowledge of God? How many times have you said, well, hey, listen, I'm no Bible scholar, and use that as an excuse for our ignorance? How many times do we say, you know, the Bible is so hard to understand, and we use that as an excuse for ignorance? There are plenty of contemporary versions of the Bible that we can read that are in our language of today and that help us to understand if we would just seek to understand. How many times do we say, I don't need the Bible to tell me how sinful I am, or I know that I'm a good person and that's good enough for me, things like that. That cause us to avoid knowledge and embrace ignorance. How many times do we say things like, I know enough about the Bible, I don't need to attend Sunday school? How many of our idols would keep us ignorant of the things of God? The answer is all of them. Anything we create that provides us an excuse to avoid becoming knowledgeable of the things of God is a pagan creation of our own. It's idolatry. It's even demonic. And the Spirit of God wants us knowledgeable of the things of God. Proverbs 4:7 says, wisdom is supreme. Therefore, get wisdom. Though it costs all you have, get understanding. As far as Paul is concerned, and as far as the writer of Proverbs is concerned, ignorance is worthless. Not knowing is worthless. I had a seminary professor who would occasionally hold up a book and he said, you need to buy this book. He felt like it was so important that we got the information that was inside that book into our head. And he said, if you can't afford it, go home, sell your bed, and buy that book. It was his way of explaining this to us how important obtaining that knowledge is. Would it surprise you that 29 of the 56 signers of the Declaration of Independence held what are today considered seminary or Bible school degrees? 29 of 56 signers. Now, I am no Bible or no math scholar, but that seems to be just about half or better. It's important to gain that knowledge of the scriptures and of theology. And then those men also, it was common for them to hold more than one university degree besides that. Become knowledgeable of spiritual things no matter how much time, effort, or money it costs you. The second point is basically a subheading of the first. First, know this. There are three things we need to know. And that Paul is emphasizing here, that we need to know. Know this. You can know what spirit is in a person by what comes out of their mouth. How do people speak of Jesus? How do you speak of Jesus? How do I speak of Jesus? The first example he gives is Jesus be cursed. Using Jesus' name, Jesus Christ, as a curse word, speaks of the type of spirit that is in that individual. And then those who speak Jesus as Lord or declare Jesus as Lord is a person who is saying so in an act of worship, whether it be at church or not. Someone whose life reflects the Lordship of Christ over that life. So, the same Spirit is not the author of each of these two ideas. Jesus be cursed. Jesus is Lord. Whoever utters the word Jesus Christ is as a curse on Monday does not speak under the influence of the Holy Spirit if they say Jesus is Lord on Sunday. Paul says we cannot claim the Holy Spirit is in us if our words say otherwise. So how do you speak of Jesus? Then by what Spirit do you speak of Jesus? Know that it is not difficult to discern between these two spirits. The second thing that we need to know, according to Paul here, is that the entire Trinity works to empower us to become the unified body of Christ. The entire Godhead works to empower us to become the unified body of Christ. First, there are different gifts, but the same Spirit. Ephesians 4, verses 3 to 7 says, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit. Just as you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. Second, so different gifts, but the same Spirit. Secondly, there's different kinds of service, but the same Lord. 1 Timothy 1, 12 to 14 says, I thank Christ Jesus, our Lord, who has given me strength that he considered me faithful, appointing me to his service. Even though I was a blasphemer and persecutor and a violent man, I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. The grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. So there are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. Third, there are different kinds of working, but the same God who works all of them in all of us. For it is God who works in us to will and to act according to His good purpose. Philippians 2:13. His good purpose is the growth and strength and unity of the church so that it can carry on our mission in the world. Go into all the world. We can't go into all the world and preach the gospel and make disciples and do so in such a way that separating from one another. We have to go with the same mission, with the same purpose, carrying that message. Whatever gifts of grace you receive, they are intended to be used to build up the rest of the church. They are for the common good, for the benefit of all members of the community. Most of them are intended to increase the spiritual knowledge of the church. Wisdom, knowledge, faith, healing, working, miracles, prophecy, discerning between spirits, tongues, interpretation of tongues. And there are lists of gifts elsewhere in the epistles from which we could add to that list. Things like hospitality, acts of service, administration, teaching, helps, etc. And I must say at this point that I have learned through many years of membership in the church and service in the church, that whatever your spiritual gift is or gifts are, these are areas where we as individuals can be tempted the most. And we need to guard against that. The amount to which we give in to those temptations coincides with how much damage we can do within relationships in the church. And for example, and someone with the gifts of administration can become controlling if they don't guard against temptation. the hospitable people, the ones with the gifts, spiritual gift of hospitality, can get chippy when people use the kitchen and don't clean their dishes or leave things on the counters. Some say, I'll use my gift only on the condition that you use your gift to do that. And so they manipulate other people. These are very, very dangerous things that we can do to destroy any unity that we might have together. There are many scenarios where a spiritual gift may be abused to the detriment of the church body. Therefore, spiritual gifts must be used by people who are filled with the Holy Spirit, living in the covenant relationship with Jesus Christ and the church. The more we concern ourselves with the things of this world, the less helpful we are for the common good. We need to be consumed with the things of God. We must all be first people of prayer and people of the Word. We must constantly be on guard against these temptations. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2 says, "Therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world. Don't behave in worldly ways using your spiritual gifts. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Think spiritually, not carnally, worldly. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. Using our spiritual gifts, we serve sacrificially, spiritual acts of worship. Know that spiritual gifts are given for the common good." The third thing that Paul wants us to know is that there are many different gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them as He determines. The Greek word for gift or spirit, the spiritual gift, is charismata. That word charis is the same word that we get our word grace from. These are graces that God gives us to grace one another with. So we must view the Holy Spirit having worked grace into our own lives gives abundant grace for the benefit and blessing of those around us. We do not control, as we heard just last week, we do not control which gifts we receive because they are gifts. We don't get to pick and choose which ones God gives us. We have only to receive and be faithful with them. So I encourage you to seek out. Should have had some sort of resource listed on that outline, and I apologize for that. If you are interested in doing a spiritual gift survey to try to understand what spiritual gifts you have that you can give to the church, please contact the office and we'll try to have something for you this week. All right?
If you would all please join me in the offering prayer, and Randy, would your young ladies like to help? Okay. And we're good. If you please join me in prayer. Divine Spirit, change our simple gifts into grace, joy for those in need. Bless and embolden our hearts that we may share our gifts with others, that we may discover in themselves the gifts of your Spirit. Amen. If the ushers will now come forth and receive the morning offering. So, calendar-wise, a week from tomorrow, Nate will be at licensing school. Is that back in Arkansas again, or? So hopefully the weather will cooperate. I've heard rumors that towards the end of January and February, we're supposed to have an active weather pattern, whatever that means. Then again, they predicted that blizzard right after Christmas. So. Sandy needs your Faith Flyer information a week from tomorrow, and she will be getting that ready and sent out that week. We've gone over all the health concerns and joys. I am looking, what is today? Tomorrow's the 18th. Ah, Kim, we have your birthday. Anybody else is here that we don't have down as a birthday or anniversary this week? How, I'm just curious, Kim, 52, 53?
Thank you. For the decade on.
That's right. We're about, yeah, you're a little older than I am. Well, let's sing happy birthday to Kim.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Now, are there any announcements? Again, the tournaments this week, I think everybody lives around here is well aware of that. Yes, please. That's right. I'm sorry. Do you want to come up here or you just want to say
something? No, I'm fine. I would like to thank the church for letting us have Kayla's baby shower yesterday and everybody that could make it and some that couldn't make it. We appreciated everything they did. So I just want to say thank you.
Good. Glad it was well for everybody. Anything else? It's a boring time of year, I guess. Please keep everybody, like we talked about, I know that for Joe it's going to be a long haul from what I gathered for her to recover, but hopefully everything will go well. I'm sure the worst part is going to be therapy once she has to try to get that going again. And also somebody that's not listed here because they asked us to kind of change it up, but I know that Gordon Hedrick is doing better, but in case you don't know, they finally gave up on the knee replacement. And so now it's simply fused. So he can get around, but he can only get around with a walker. And in fact, they moved into a one-story duplex sort of thing, so he didn't have to cope with stairs, but he's doing well. We've got a lot of people in our lives, here, there, everywhere. And sometimes we get way too busy and forget about them. Yeah, I mean, he's home. The best thing is he's not in that care facility anymore, so that means that Danita wasn't having to drive out every day and back and forth. And I don't know if Pam would do that. Anyway, if you would all please join me, and Tristan, if you would like to get ready to extinguish the candles, we will be singing hymn number 140, Great is Thy Faithfulness. And you can stay seated. You don't have to stand. I'll make you stand for the blessing.
Oh,
There are many gifts, but one Spirit. There are many services, but one Lord. We offer our gifts in the service of the living Christ. We offer our gifts to the service of others and the delight of the living God.